that I use. So I'm the facility manager for this building, as well as our corporate headquarters in Redwood City and another regional office down in San Jose. I've been with DPR 20 years. November of last year was my 20th anniversary. First job out of college, started off as a courier, moved into the building, had the opportunity about 6 years ago through a regional manager in Redwood City. The guy at the time, the facility manager, wasn't up to par, or the management decided that they wanted to make a change. They offered me an opportunity and jumped in head first. So I've been taking on the facility management duties for about 6 years now. Start off in Redwood City with a three-story, 53,000 square foot building. Lots of lessons learned there. It's kind of a dinosaur building compared to this building. That building, pneumatics, integrated, you know, it's not as smart as this building here. Jumped on board with this building here in May of 2014. We've been here almost 3 years, and it's been a constant learning experience. Lots of things learned, lots of challenges, but in the end, I think we're achieving what our goal is, and that's to have a beautiful, efficient, net positive, net zero building, and we've been able to manage that. I worked a lot closely with Honeywell. Integral Group was part of the design of this building. They introduced me to different platforms that allow me to kind of manage the building and give me insight as to when something's wrong or something's running efficiently. This is the building OS platform here. That this is my first point. Let me rewind a little bit. On a day-to-day basis, I use my Honeywell platform for this building to just give me information. We'll go online. If you guys saw the command wall and the EBI platform, I use that to just give me information. I look on it daily. I look for green lights, make sure everything is running. I look at temperatures to make sure everything is within dead band. Yes, sir.
So you're that's kind of your office. You're using that wall. You're not accessing it from your laptop.
Sometimes I'm in Redwood City and I need to see what's going on in San Francisco. So yes, I do. I use my computer, and fortunately, Honeywell offers a iPad, which is even easier than my computer. My computer, I gotta get into VPN and back in here, password there. With my iPad, it's just one password, takes me directly to the screen. Computer, it's easier to manipulate just because it's a bigger screen, keyboard, and all that good stuff. But on my iPad, when it comes to convenience, I mentioned in the group that I had with me, I was in Mexico 1 year and the doors wouldn't lock. So I grabbed my iPad, jumped online, hit go, and it worked. Much easier. And that allows me to be mobile. Good, great platform. So the building OS allows for, this is the heat map. This essentially tells me when the building is on or off. Looks like the green signifies off. The yellow and the green and the oranges, the red means we're at full capacity. That's the maximum power that we're using. There is a scale at top that lets us know how much energy we're using. I believe this is in kilowatts. So it will tell me what the status is on a day-to-day basis. If I pull the arrow over a certain section, it will give me the exact time and how much power we're using. This particular day, Thursday, May 5th, we had an event, and that's why the orange stays through until 2 a.m. because we were here cleaning, trying to get the building ready for the next day. This is a platform that I use to just let me know when our mechanical equipment is doing what it's supposed to do. I cannot track back. So in November, there was a point in time where our ERVs stayed on the whole night, and we were for the whole month, and we were able to recognize that. And that's when we noticed that we needed to repair something because something wasn't working. I'm trying to find that area, and it doesn't look like it's, I can't find the breakdown, but it was 1 month. But here we had another event. You can see that it stayed on all night. Just a tool that I use to help me manage the building and let me know when equipment is staying on or is staying off. So there are tabs where we can set up trend analysis. I want to check how ERV2 is performing. It'll give me a breakdown. I can specify particular areas that are of focus. And I honestly rely a lot on Integral Group to help me out with this portion. They produce reports for us and tell us, okay, something happened in November with your consumption and usage. What happened? Did you have any extra parties that night? Were there events? And so I lean on them a lot. So for instance, this tab here will tell me, okay, well, this year compared to last year, well, this is the first year, right? So we get the first month of the year, so we can't really say. But last year, in January, we were here. This year, we're here. So looks like we're actually trending about the same. That is one platform that assists me. But again, the EBI is really, really kind of the backbone of the tool that I used for managing this particular building. Yes, sir.
I'd be curious to see what your load profile is. Can you do a midnight to midnight? Like on a typical weekday?
That will be a tab that I'm going to have to do a little searching for.
And it, because they implemented that kill switch, that has had a huge impact.
So fortunately, our night crew is very good and consistent about hitting the kill switch. So when they hit that kill switch, and that will usually happen about 10 o'clock. So you'll see, you know, during the day, first person walks in. So this is kind of our baseline here, right? That's the amount of energy we're using from 12 midnight to 5 in the morning. Somebody comes in, somebody sneaks in about, you know, 4:30, 5 o'clock, and we start going up. By 7 o'clock, we're really using energy because people are turning their computers on, people are getting their coffee, the coffees are coming on, people are really starting to kind of get their day started, and throughout the day it fluctuates.
And the kill switch did have a few issues, you know, kind of making sure that non-critical loads were not being shut off, and so we were able to, through the alarming, find out, I think, one of the card readers was actually, or door locks was actually getting cut off, and things like that, so it's, you know, implementing a kill switch after the fact is a little difficult because you've got to be so cognizant of what is on what circuit. But it's definitely something that should be thought about early on as you're designing buildings because it has a huge impact.
Right. You know. So
how is the staff notified which are those particular circuits? Is each outlet marked? Is it a non-critical load?
When the design of the building was put together, Ray and Mike Messick and Dylan Connolly with the Integral Group, they sat down in a room and said, okay, and again, at first it probably started off as a conceptual thought, like, okay, well, we're just going to, everybody's station is going to turn off at 6 o'clock. But what if that person stays and works till 7? You can't. So every single workstation has a formula, an equation written into it, that allow, for instance, if you're not docked into your workstation, yes, power is going to your workstation, but if your computer is not physically docked into your station, then your monitors will turn off. There's no need for your monitors to be on. Mm-hmm. If you have your computer docked in and you walk away and you don't come back within 10 minutes, your computer and your station is gonna go into sleep mode and everything's gonna power down. So through the Edmetric platform, there are equations written in that manipulate what your workstation should be doing. You walk back, it's in sleep mode, or it's in sleep, you hit the power button and everything lights up and you can get back to work.
Thanks for showing me
that. Yeah, no, so again, you see 6 o'clock, you know, things start kind of winding down. 8:30, the night crew shows up, we have a little bit of a spike, they're here for a couple hours, and obviously they're not using all the workstations, they're just using the big ass fans are on, for instance, the lighting per zone is on, when they go into the bathrooms. So this is an excellent tool for information, and this gives me insight to say, okay, something happened last month, something happened this week, or again, as mentioned, Integral Group will come to me and say, hey, dude, you used a little more energy last month than you typically do. What did you do? I'll refer back to this. I'll refer to the building OS, the heat map. And it'll give me some kind of clue. I'll go back into my files and, oh, you know what? We had an event on the 12th of January that kept the systems on for a little bit longer. So Also, the Honeywell platform as well, and along with the Attune.
I have a couple of slides. Sure. If you want to bring those up on the Attune.
Let me click back and forth here.
That is the architecture there. That just shows all the different systems that are tied in. All these are different subsystems that were tied in and integrated to operate as a holistic whole. Those were all the items that you took them through individually. And then this just hits on the leak dynamic plaque a little bit. We can share this with you, Pam, this slide deck. So, but most of this stuff you had on the tour, so we're not going to walk through it. This is how Edmundo felt at first with all the stuff coming at it.
Can you go back to that one though about BIM modeling?
Because BIM modeling was one of the initiatives we had when we were putting the command wall in, was how can we make use of the BIM model?
Yeah.
So, and this was part of the goal we were looking at, what kind of use cases can we build? We were really looking at, can we take the data that's populated in the BIM model and make it a living tool? And even we were hoping to take it to the point where we were even using the COBE compliant information that then could be used to help automate some of the programming of it. And we continue to work with DPR on these endeavors. DPR is a leader in BIM modeling. And so we've worked with them to say, how do you make it more usable for operators and facility groups? There's a lot of investment that goes into creating that BIM. How do you make it more usable so it's not just something that gets put in a file and never looked at again? So really trying to use the BIM files for the displays that you see. Most of the stuff you see on the command wall, though we do use the BIM models, we've really found it to be more applicable when you take it into the iPad. We don't have that to show you today, but what we've did with DPR is some of the BIM modeling as a tool that's in on the iPad. You actually can take the command wall, and today we don't have that loaded yet, and swipe it onto your iPad, and it's really to put the power of the tool set into the hands of the people in the field is what we're trying to do there. But here, this was, there's just a lot of, you can imagine the amount of data. Or Edmundo is.
Countless hours with the Honeywell technician.
Yeah, there's a lot of data, and it can be overwhelming. And so one of the things we did was we put in place the Attune package to try to distill the data down to actionable events. And where do you focus?
Just looking at that previous slide, right, regarding BIM modeling and the HVAC network, right? So does that allow you basically to have a visualization of the HVAC systems, or does it also integrate energy usage and equipment performance?
We're in pilot states on all of this stuff, so it's really getting formulated. So if there are clients that are very interested in aggressive use of BIM model, we would love to connect up with them this is really the BIM is really the forefront.
It allows you to conceptually kind of design something and really apply theory to what the goal you're trying to achieve. It allows you to visualize it, see it in a drawing, in a 3D drawing or a 4D drawing, and then apply it to real life scenarios.
And some of the challenges we're having as we begin to go down that is, how do you integrate in the work order management information and some of that kind of stuff, and a lot of these different systems, bringing the information together. Where does the master really belong? So it's really cutting edge for the industry right now, and trying to formulate some level of standards around how is it applied, and how do you harness the power? Because there's a lot of information. The BIM models that the DPR creates with most of their buildings, it's a very rich model with a lot of data.
Layers and layers.
Yeah, so like we're one of the things that we got into as we began to try to use it as a programming tool is nomenclature. And what, anybody that's been in construction, one of the things that kills us in construction is nomenclature, because what you call a room, you know, in construction tends to change when the building's in operation. Well, now if you use that as the basis for your identification of equipment and it all changes, right? So the industry has a lot of changing it has to do to, I think, really make BIM a very transferable model for building operations.
But it's, I think it could be a great tool for keeping as built up to date.
Oh, they've got a service group that does that. They offer keeping built BIM models fresh.
Right? We have a team of people who specialize in the BIM modeling. And, you know, obviously they work in conjunction with different teams to make sure that all the elements of building are taken into account. I mean, I've not personally had the experience of looking at a full BIM model, but I understand that, you know, you have your electrical, your mechanical, your piping, all the different layers in a building are included in the BIM modeling. And it's a really fascinating thing. And as Janey has said that, I believe that, yeah, DPR is one of the leaders in the industry, if not the leader in BIM modeling. I mean,
I was going to add, not only knowing the location of the equipment, but then having history on the service of that equipment. I mean, it really takes it up to the highest level.
Absolutely.
For M&O.
Absolutely.
Well, when you begin to think about prefabrication, I mean, that's part of what, you know, BIM is being driven through the efficiencies it creates in construction. You know, you walk through a mechanical contractor's plant today, they're taking that BIM model and they're fabricating, you know, the piping and the sheet metal, and it's all being fabricated from the BIM model as the source. It is pretty amazing. So trying to make use of that after the building is built. These are just a couple of slides around analytics to help, you know, where do you focus?
How do I identify problem areas? So part of this Attune package that we have with Honeywell is on a monthly basis, a team will give me a call, we'll sit down, we'll have a conference call, and we'll talk about the different aspects of the building. In this particular slide, it just kind of shows you a temperature deviation in set points in November. This information just basically lets me know, like, okay, well, we're not variating too much, 1-2 degrees, which lets me know that the building is having a proper morning warm-up period. Lets me know that everything is shutting down at the right time, and throughout the night it's maintaining and keeping us within a particular dead band. Now, you know, if this were drastic and there was a 10 to 15 degree variation, then we would be able to identify this hypothetically if it was fan coil unit 1-5 and there's a variance of 10 degrees. And that's going to alert me right away, red flag, and say there's something going on with that unit. Something happened on a particular day. Let's investigate further. From there, I will take the different tools that we have through the EBI or through the building OS or the Lucid, for instance, and try to figure out and problem solve what was it that caused that issue. Was there a power surge? Did the equipment fail, et cetera, et cetera. So again, useful tool. Month to month, we talk and just making sure that we're staying on track and following through with what our goal is.
And then another screen here is around monitoring, like the kill switch, and they just give a couple of items to say, hey, you know, it's getting disabled at 8 p.m. on weekdays. Well, yeah, that makes sense.
The night crew's coming in at 8 o'clock.
Managers are coming in. Hey, just want to give you a heads up that this device never enabled. You know, so there's something going on here. So it's giving them actions, and this is recommendations that actually comes with the report. So it's giving you the data and then the recommended actions. So you're not having to every day deal with an overflow of an abundance of data. Just what are the things I've got to focus on? Where do I have issues?
And included in that program is If something during the night happens, if an ERV turns off in the middle of the night or turns on in the middle of the night and it's not supposed to be doing that, then if it's an emergency, depending on the level of severity, then I get a phone call. Literally, it tells me, hey, haven't had it happen, and hope it doesn't happen, but if my cameras get tampered with, if the card reader gets unmounted from the from the wall, then I'm in a tune. Honeywell's going to get an alert. They're going to get on the phone, and they're going to call me and say, your camera is offline. It's either been tampered with, or it's faulty, or something's not right, and then we'll work together to resolve that situation.
So what are your questions? Or because you've kind of gotten a very quick overview. Is there any area you want to look at more deeply, or do you have any questions that we should touch on?
Could you switch back to that integration slide?
Oh, the architecture.
Yeah.
So it's all IP based. So it's BACnet. The bulk of it is BACnet over IP. There is some Modbus tied into the system. Did you have questions on the architecture?
I was just curious how we're integrating with each of these.
Yeah, so different using different protocols. So either BACnet over IP or Modbus or the two protocols.
So I see a couple of points here where you're calling out Modbus RS-232 and 485 both on the solar systems. Are you using some kind of converter to bring it up to Ethernet and then also to back it at the same
yeah.
time?
No, no, we're using Modbus. As I mentioned, we came in after the fact, so all the equipment had been selected. We tend to like BACnet over IP because the discovery
it's easy.
Side of it. Yeah,
it's the right, just a wire connection set into the server, set into the control panel, and then it allows for direct access to those particular elements.
Yeah. Or with Modbus, we have to get the conversion tables, and the conversion tables may not be accurate. And yeah, so it's, BACnet over IP is much simpler on the discovery end.
Talk a little bit about software and about sort of maybe updates for security after the fact. So you've got the thing running, you've kind of done some initial tests. We pretty much locked it down and things are, now that they're operating the way they want, you've sort of...
So they, in their service agreement, they do get a refresh, so they get an upgrade in there. But yeah, one of the first things we did, because 18 months into it, we did see the performance degrading. We came in and did a health assessment of the system to see, okay, well, what's changed? And so what we wanted to do is get to that point where you could lock it down before we started to do improvements. We're now wanting to put in the next piece of improvements and demo, which is the outcome-based services. So we're talking to DPR about now, okay, let's now move to the next place, yeah. But you've got to get stable and, you know, at 100% before you then now try the next new thing.
We also, just for kind of peace of mind, we also invited Integral Group back in to do a post-occupancy commissioning where we went through every single system to make sure it was performing the way it should. So, again, just to kind of, for instance, the BIM, layer after layer of information, with all the smart systems in place in this building, Janey has mentioned, it isn't just, it's there, it's done, we're walking away. There comes a point in time, I strongly believe, that you got to come in, you got to evaluate the system, you got to recommission it, so to speak, and verify, keep the system honest to really know that it is performing the way it was designed. And I mean, equipment fails, things fail, wires come undone, things get tampered with, and so sometimes there is a need to really just come back and just ensure, make sure that everything's nice and tight and communicating the way it should. And so around the time where we discovered kind of that
yeah.
dip, we took that opportunity at the same time to say, hey guys, come in, let's make sure and ensure that this is not only, I mean, because what's on the internet or what's on the computer may vary from what is actual. And so we needed to confirm that what we were reading on the computer was actually physically happening with our equipment, and it helped us out because we're at cruise control. I think everything is performing the way it should.
So the next piece we would like to test here now is that outcome-based services, which is basically continuous commissioning, where it's through analytics that's constantly running it through the design intent and telling you if you're varying across that.
Thank you. Changing the subject a little bit, I noticed on one of the graphics that it looked like the energy recovery ventilators, the RVs, were using a good portion of the energy during the day sometime. Was any thought given to, and the reason I say this is because we occupy a building that has natural ventilation sequences, and when the windows open up, we're in the middle of downtown Eugene, and the people on the first floor have complained about having dust all over their desktops. I was wondering if there was any thought given to implementing natural ventilation here, where you wouldn't have to use the ERVs at certain times.
So this was an existing building. This building happens to be placed in a historic area of San Francisco, and so the city doesn't allow you to do too much manipulation to the actual shell of the building. What we have existing are just a couple windows that open up and close. The idea behind the ERV was to also use the big-ass fans to kind of circulate, and based on temperature, the ERVs phase themselves and pull in the amount of air to balance out with the gas fans and the CO2 levels. So again, smart system equipment on the roof. It isn't on or off, open or closed. It's okay, you're at this CO2 level, it's this temperature, let's bring in a little bit of outside air and kind of integrate it and mix it with what you have as an existing condition.
Yeah, in California we have Title 24, so you may not have that all over the country, but it is very strict around mandating minimum ventilation requirements, and so we have lots of extra requirements that are put on our buildings and our control systems as
right,
a result.
Right. And you know, part of our mechanical equipment function and maintaining operation is I have Envise. Envise is kind of the service department for Southland Industries. Have a PM agreement with these guys. They come in on a quarterly basis. They check all the belts, the motors, the filters. You know, we use high efficiency filters. I think we're at MERV 13 filters in this building. So we're following the green industry protocol and making sure that all their equipment is running at optimal rate. Yes, sir.
So, you know, the building's cool. A lot of neat things in it. I get the point that this is a statement building for you as a company. What, it's kind of a two-phase question. Dollars and cents wise, you know, for your typical building owner, is there any practicality to going towards something like this from what you see? And what type of time commitment is this taking relative to some of your other buildings on a per square foot basis? Because I see a lot of complexity built into what is a relatively small space, and it's cool. I like it. I understand the mission of that, but you know, the typical Jane or Joe building owner doesn't want necessarily.
How much is this?
I don't foresee they're going to want to put the investment in there. So, from what you guys have done from economic standpoint, comparing, you know, not just the cost but your time and stuff like that, where does that all sit?
Well, so I will try and answer that question the best that I can. That is. It's right here. He's not here.
He's said 7.5 years.
So Ray was really part of the building of this space. He and Mike Messig and, you know, some higher ups got together and so DPR Construction is an ever forward thinking organization. We want to be better. How can we better? What can we do to make things better? And so you're right. We do spend a lot of time really taking surveys and analysis and getting people's opinions and people's feedback. We happen to have a really strong networking circle. I mean, we've been in the construction industry for 27 years. You know, and it may not seem like that long, but when you take trends to be a leader in the industry and learn smart systems and apply those systems and offer them to your clients and say, hey, this is what we're capable of. One of our slogans is we build great things. And it is our goal to try to achieve the best of the best of the best, right? Mm-hmm. And so in terms of what I think what we're trying to accomplish in this building is, first and foremost, we want to build a space that for us ourselves is going to be comfortable, it's going to be exciting, it's going to be all the things we would want to present to our customers. Again, I'm kind of speaking out of turn here because I was a product price. I will give you kind of my personal perspective and my opinions of what I think, and having been with the company over, you know, a little bit over 20 years, I've seen the ups and downs of how the construction industry has changed a little bit. The benefit into a building like this is demonstrating that you know, we're moving into times where, saving the world is important. Right. I mean, we can't just go around wasting energy. We can't waste water. We can't, you know, if there's an opportunity to reuse material, let's try to implement that, and so that we can, you know, save this world for. And it's a very simplistic kind of notion. What I'm saying, you know, it's kind of cliché-ish, if you will, but it's a realistic approach. Trying to sell it to a client and say, oh, you know what? Yes, it's going to cost you a little more. But in the long run, you know, this building here is going to be a means of verifying and confirming that the efforts that we're making, we're living proof that if you take this approach, and yes, maybe up front it'll cost you a little bit more, but think of the long run. Mm-hmm. You know, I mean, for instance, we looked at the energy consumption. Mm-hmm. We're net positive, 12%. In within 3 years, let's just, you know, for sake of argument, 10%. We're net positive 10%. So if we can continue that along the way, we could justify that and say, yes, okay, maybe you're spending a little bit upfront, but you're not using as much energy. Our PG&E bill here for a 20,000 square foot building for the first year, our PG&E bill was $20 a month because we were producing so much solar. Well, we're producing much more solar than using solar. So $20 a month for a PG&E bill for a 24,000 square foot building with a tenant, and we have all these smart systems in place. I mean, an owner's got to be able to turn back and say, wow, that's pretty impressive. Ray, I'm glad you're here. I hope I answered at least part of your question.
Yeah, I just wanted to see where you were. The issue would be that not every building has you there to be able to do that, you know,
right.
keep it going.
Right.
That's
in,
a big
in terms
thing.
Of what,
although we'd love to train a lot of views to do that.
In terms of what this building costs us, so the question was, in a nutshell, what, it's a fantastic building. We have all these smart systems in place. How could we go to an owner? How can we go to an owner and say, hey, by utilizing all these smart systems and all these things and putting all these things in place, what's the value in this?
Yeah, right. There's going to be the upfront cost, right, which is putting those systems in place. But then long term down the road is that, you know, instead of Edmundo spending 40 hours a week, you know, managing this building with the systems in place, right, he's only really utilizing 10, 20 hours of his time for this building alone, right? So is there a number out there? I mean, we could go and run an analysis and do that, because, you know, I would have to have Edmundo start kind of really coding his hours and looking at that type of thing. But yeah, it's a premium, you know, whatever it was, maybe, like I said, we were trying to get about to $200 a square foot. Maybe it was a premium of about 10 to 15%, right? In a normal TI build out, right? To pay that upfront cost upfront. But then long term, down the way, you know, depending on how many hours is this, you know, he coding to this hour or to this building, is he spent actually managing the building? Where with all those systems in place, he doesn't need to spend as many hours. You know, he can do it remotely, even just looking at his computer, looking at his trends, because a lot of these systems report out the information that he lives. All right, things are looking good, you know, and that type of thing. So we don't have anybody out there who's running the calcs and run the numbers. But, you know, I know that's something that probably our executive management team have looked at, right? Because now it's like, well, then if it's so great, why don't we do this to every, you know, office?
Does it have $200 a square foot, including all the mechanical energy management systems?
Say it again, sorry?
Is that $200 a square foot, including all the
Building management systems,
yeah.
Energy.
And I do have a detailed breakout. That's a rough number. It excludes basically, you know, there's some soft costs with some engineering and whatnot. Like I said, it doesn't include some of the family friend discounts type of stuff. But, you know, that was our goal. And I think when it's all said and done, I think we were roughly, honestly, about like $205. We were around there. And our goal is to be somewhere around.
But you got a life cycle cost because you got a lot of energy savings.
Correct.
Yeah,
correct.
I was gonna say, yeah, you probably have a.
Yeah.
What's the percent total cost of the new construction versus the life cycle cost? I mean, I think it's like less than 10% is the cost of construction versus, you know.
Well, I think that we may be asking the wrong question because this is a valuation question and we want to look at it in terms of dollars and cents. But what is DPR's product, right? You are providing human services and what these people offer. So since you have three other locations, my question is really, the people that work here, how do they feel about this space? Do they tend to be more productive, lower absenteeism? Do they like being in this space? Because as a business owner, I would be more concerned about that. How does my team feel in this space and what it presents?
Yeah.
It's so much more dynamic and creative and interactive. And I think that that's really the true value.
Yeah, I mean, we do have our employee satisfaction surveys that we do out, and I don't know how often, if it's yearly or
we're going to start doing it quarterly now.
Quarterly. but those are the type of information that we want to bring in and evaluate. And yeah, we haven't done that. You know,
what do people say? Like, what do they say when they got?
Exactly. And that's all we have to go off of right now. It's not on paper for us to pull up a report and look at.
Sort of.
But it's a conversation. Yeah.
I'll tell you what people are saying.
But what people are saying is you know, I love this building coming in here. You know, like I said, we were coming from a place that was kind of the dumps a little bit, you know, but for us, it was a big thing and I was talking to someone here earlier was, you know, we talked the talk, and now we wanted to walk the walk, right? We advertise ourselves as green builders, being, you know, net positive is something we really want to pursue. And if we're over there sitting in a space that we're using portable heaters and not being aware of how much, you know, energy we're consuming, we wanted to walk the walk and actually do that.
So that's part of this survey was taken in. This is part of the Lead Dynamic Black Survey platform. This survey was taken in the last quarter of last year. So I believe it was September. There's satisfaction rating. A lot of people gave it 10, 9, 8, 10 fives, and maybe 1-4.
Can't make everybody happy.
What's the size? What's the end of this? You know,
how many
were
people
completed?
Surveyed?
Yeah, was it 200 or 40?
No,
or?
it was what do you say?
343%.
42 people? Right, that's our occupancy.
About 40 people or so?
No, so that's 42, 46 workstations. Actually, there's 90 plus San Francisco employees. A lot of people are out on job sites.
So you're looking around 100?
Around 100.
Okay.
So satisfaction rating? The dissatisfaction level, and these are
yes.
the different areas that people thought were a problem.
I don't know
so
if we have that.
It's too loud.
But we should have that.
It's too hot. It's too cold. Privacy, and then other. Doesn't tell me what the other element was. You know, the loud. When this building was designed and built, there was a purpose, right? We have an open office environment here. We want people to network. We want people to talk to one another. We want teams to collaborate and work together. Maybe there's some people who have been used to working in a cubicle, in an office, by themselves. That, in this environment, isn't conducive to that mentality and that previous work style. Too hot, too cold. That is a challenge that we've dealt with our mechanical equipment. Okay, well, let's find the balance. Let's find out how we can, you know, I mean, literally, maybe let's move some people around. Maybe we put the hot-blooded people with the hot-blooded people, or put the cold-blooded people. It's a living lab. So we're constantly trying to figure out how it is we can have everybody kind of be even killed. Privacy that goes along with loud. I mean, yes, you can't have a private conversation if you're sitting in an open office environment. But there are two rooms upstairs that are for phone calls and privacy. There are the conference rooms. You can go outside. And so it's a behavior, kind of a behavioral thing as well, that we need to kind of adjust and adapt to our circumstances and our environment. You're right. This is a very unique building. We don't do things like everybody else. We're striving for that uniqueness for the experience. And so these are some of the dissatisfaction subjects that people saw. Other, I don't know what it could be. It could be anything. I was not.
Did you do an acoustic profile in the BIM?
Yeah, we. I don't know if we went as far as that, but we did have Salters come out of the acoustic consultant mm-hmm. help provide us just with some preliminary type of criteria to meet.
So yeah, to kind of answer your question, those were the different areas yeah. where we suffered.
the big part, and I've had a lot of people come in and say, yeah, the question you had asked is, so what are people saying? Do they like it? And it's easy for me to say, yeah, they do. But, you know, part of it was the upfront work we did is we just didn't, you know, close shop there and open up shop and everybody walks in and like, wow, this is great, but it's different, right? We prepared them. We had family breakfast 4-5-6 months in advance. Even when we were talking about doing this, we said, hey, we're looking to find a new space. We're going to go for the big nugget, net positive, you know, all those type of things. And so we started preparing people, saying there's going to be a change, but it's going to be a change for the good, right, type of thing. And we're all comfortable, and I keep bringing up portable heaters because that's huge over there.
Well, we all got like a goodie bag, right?
Yeah, yeah.
Everybody, we
started preparing them, family breakfast, getting them involved, letting them see our plan, letting them know where we're at, getting them prepared of what type of things we're going to implement in the space. And then, you know, so it wasn't just that shell shock when they show up type of thing. And people appreciated that because they felt like they were being involved and engaged, and they were part of this plan that we had in place, you know.
So, just a quick question. So, for the portable heater addicts,
yeah.
did you slip like a little thermal blanket in
yeah,
your
bag? Yeah, if we don't hit it, we provide little goodie bags and
okay.
get them some user guidelines of some new features, electronic features that were in the space.
Yeah.
We gave them a water bottle, but, you know, a little warm blanket
okay.
to throw over. And once again, you know, And you had asked, you know, for me, you know, personally, I live in Walnut Creek, East Bay, which is 25 miles, but it's across the bay. I was driving to work every day with my Jeep, you know, Cherokee gas guzzler, you know. It mentally hit me, and I barred in every day now. And so the impact that this building had on me personally was that. Now I barred into the city and try to lessen my carbon footprint. And if you walk around the space when people are here and you ask them one thing that, people are going to come up with their own example of how the influence of this space has influenced them to change something during their...
We have people that bike in. We have a guy that's got an electronic skateboard, you know. I used to ride a bike into work also, catch Caltrain. I live in Redwood City. I used to catch Caltrain.
Yeah. So, I mean, if you went around and interviewed, you know, all our... I think they would provide you with one or two things that they felt that the impact of this building has changed kind of their everyday life. And to me, that's the impact that we're trying to make, and hopefully little by little, we can continue that and grow out into the bigger community.
This slide, for instance, kind of shows us our transportation modes. This was in October, September, right? And I apologize, I can't remember when it was exactly, but when I'm going to send out another email pretty soon. It is possible, Ray's not going to be in the car solo category anymore. So this is going to go down, and he's going to switch over to a heavy rail and walk. Right, so it is we are in a constant journey and constant determined to really make our experience here in this building and kind of justify and prove to everybody and to ourselves that we're doing what we can for the sake of the world, to be honest with you.
And we know that could change. Next week some new great technology will come out, and that's the whole living lab I keep on expressing is someone new might be out there and let's try it. Let's see if it works. Why not? So that's part of the concept here is bringing in new vendors, new suppliers with new products, new things to kind of see, well, where can we save time? Where can we save energy? And to me, that's also part of the DPR culture of who we are. Just, you know, faster, smarter, better. You know, just trying to bring in those people with innovative minds and trying to think out of the box. And we're only talking construction here, but we feel there's a bigger picture there, too.
So you guys going to get an earplug dispenser?
No? So with the design of the building and your desire to keep the structure open like it was, then to say that noisy is your biggest complaint, I think you should be patting yourself on the back.
Yeah.
Because there's no way that, you know, bouncing sound waves off that hard roof, you could have put a suspended ceiling in, and that would just would have defeated the architectural purpose of the building.
Right.
So.
And if we go and add walls and ceilings, then it defeats our purpose of, you know, we're big on collaboration, right? We want to be able to poke our head up and jump over and yell something to a question and estimate, hey, what's the square footage cost of a car? You know, this collaboration, this kind of being able to just, you know, ask any of our colleagues sitting over there, this and that. And to me, that's efficiency, productivity, and just having that collaboration mindset of who we are and the people that we're trying to build over here with smart builders, technical builders type things. And so that's where, you know, our DPR kind of had some wine and came together and said, let's just break down all those walls, right?
Did your website have some, like, a portfolio of some of the projects that you've constructed?
Yes, definitely. And we have our five major market sectors: commercial, higher education, biopharmaceutical, healthcare, and corporate offices. And so those are five major sectors. And so you'll see a lot of those projects within those. There'll be some kind of cool, unique ones because clients will come to us and say, I want you to help me build this. But yeah, a lot of the projects are highlighted on our website currently. Yeah, and they vary. They vary from, you know, we change out a door for a client down the street for, you know, $2,500 to, you know, $200 billion projects. So there's a large kind of bandwidth that we go to work through. Gentlemen?
Yeah, I had a question for Janey. How does this project fit within the big scheme of things for Honeywell? I mean, is this like a one-off or really hybrid environment here, or are you seeing applications beyond
the question that, you know, you don't generally see a system this sophisticated on a 25,000 square foot facility. But also it's important to learn in a smaller environment that's more tightly contained with fewer variables. So really we've embraced the living lab concept, and I think that's a lot of what you guys are about, is trying to create living lab environments. It's a much safer environment to learn from. This learning that we had through this exercise of the three objectives we had could have been incredibly costly if it had been on that $100 million project, right? So it's, and this was not something that was executed, by our local business alone. We had experts flying in from all over. I mean, this is truly a living lab. We, you know, want to take it to the next place and the next level. So it's been a phenomenal experience for Honeywell. Plus, the exposure that our system gets, because, you know, DPR has opened this up to be a showplace for their clients and for the community as a whole. And so it really, it's been great to let the community as a whole begin to see what the potential is, because, you know, when you let your creativity go and you begin to realize what the potential is, there's no bounds to what we can do. I mean, there really isn't. And it's just been exciting to work with business and thought leaders like DPR, because, you know, they're clearly pushing the envelope on what a building should look like today. And it's, you know, it's remarkable what you can do. So it's been a great experience for Honeywell.
Larry, I think wants to mention.
Yeah, let's just take two more questions. Otherwise, I'm just going to start eating without them.
The question is, do you have any data on previous occupancy in this building? What their energy use was
for this building specifically?
Yes.
You're saying no, we didn't have any of that information, but we did have, of course, the someone had asked about some of the models and analysis we had did for this building. So we took our previous building that we, or the previous spot where we were at. So I know it's not, you know, but we were trying to understand, you know, the way we operated there, Exactly. Same, some of the uses there, and then bring it here to apply to help us figure out what those trends would be, and of course, figuring out what then the solar panel array system would be to offset that. So we did take some of that analysis there, but not a very exactly of the previous year.
So when I keep in mind recapping, if you didn't have all the technology you have here, it was what you would see if you were down the street looking at Joe's building.
Yeah.
What would the power bill be on a monthly basis for this building? You just told us it was about $20.
So for the first year, the PG&E bill,
yeah,
because of the smart systems and solar production.
Well, my own bill is over $250.
We have a San Jose office. San Jose office, it's probably a third of this building.
Mm-hmm.
And we don't have those smart systems in place. Maybe it's at max, maybe a 15,000 square foot. Our monthly bill there is $1,900, $1,800.
It's not going
to
be big
money. So our Redwood City office, not smart at all, unfortunately, 53,000 square feet. Our monthly bill is $16,000. And we have five tenants on the first floor, two floors occupied for DPR and all that good stuff. So maybe that gives you a little bit of perspective. I mean, it wouldn't be $20 and it wouldn't be $16, but.
Yeah. Did he tell you do you remember what the number was for that very first? We sent out a blast email. It was $4.19 for that
first month bill. Yeah, for PG&E.
That was awesome.
Yeah, for the short one.
Yes.
Yeah.
Now you're generating
power,
right?
Yes.
Yeah.
That means that you're getting money back.
Okay.
Are you getting any pushback from the utilities? I've been reading, I've been working with the Midwest Regional Energy Association, et cetera, about utilities saying, that's the way it's been, but we're really not going to honor this positive, because they're not being able to get enough cash flow coming in. Are you getting any of that here? Or
no.
Are you managing it in any way, or have you heard rumblings, and maybe because it's California, you've got a different mindset than Midwest does or something?
Fortunately, you're exactly right. Being in California, there's always this big push for green, energy efficiency and whatnot. So for the most part, PG&E, from that standpoint, is on board with us. Sometimes we're even, I think, a little bit of ahead of the game. We've had some members of DPR were on the USGC and whatnot, and so they were kind of starting the discussions with PG&E about then if you don't have a program for that, we should start, those type of talks. And so for the most part, being that we are in California and, green standards and, new buildings coming in San Francisco have to meet a certain level, fortunately, we don't get the pushback. Now, we get the pushback when we need them to actually put the work in place out in the street. That's a different story. That's a tougher batch. But, with a big agency like that, you're always going to have kind of those challenges.
So, Carol, you're getting into the policy arena?
Yes.
And that's varied by cities and states. That's why I was mentioning that initiative in Florida that would have really cut the life out of solar just with one.
To add a little bit to what Ray was saying, we did have a sustainability manager on site to kind of work with the project, who then hooked up with an individual from Energy Solution, who then got in touch with somebody at PG&E and talked about what we're trying to accomplish. PG&E in California, you're right, doesn't have any programs for such type of building. So they had to kind of build a unique program for us and put us on a specific PG&E rate where we're contributing back to the grid and we're not being charged as much. And so, but that's all language and information that I, just tell me how to make it work.
Okay.
We should get you guys a grab.
Thank you.
We don't want it to get cold, but